Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining. We've got lots of you on the call here, being here promptly, so thanks so much. I'm sure quite a few of you will be dropping in the next couple of minutes. And of course, we'll make the recording available as well. If you know any parents that didn't see it, we'll send that recording out and it will go on the website as usual. First of all, I hope you're really all well. You're all safe, all your families are all well. And hopefully eagerly anticipating the students returning to school on Monday, which I'm sure will be the main topic of the meeting today. We've had a bit of a day of it today in school, I've got to be honest with you. So we had a complete network outage this morning. First time in 3 years that I've been at school that we've had that. So I've been running around various places in South London trying to find somewhere that works. So I've ended up indoors. I haven't got a very reliable internet connection here. So if it does go kaput, then we will just do this again. I'm also told that the website went down briefly about an hour or so ago as well. So if something can go wrong today, then it certainly will. But never mind, we'll make the best of it. And thanks for sticking with us. Okay, so the three main things I want to go through with you today are the reopening plans, particularly for next week. The subsequent weeks after that will pretty much run as normal. The various COVID protective measures that we've got in school to keep everyone safe. Within that, I'll include more details about the lateral flow testing and face coverings. I'm sure you'll want to know more about that. A little bit about expectations on students returning to school, and then I'll just touch on exam arrangements for year 11 and 13. But in reality, I can't say a great deal about that at the moment, but I'm very happy to do what I can. In the background, as usual, we've got Ray Reeves, our IT guru, making it all work. And we've got Mr. Hall, our vice principal. He's taking questions from you at the moment. So please keep firing your questions into chat. And I hope we can make it as interactive as possible when I'm responding to questions rather than just me droning on as usual. So I'm resisting the temptation to use slides as well. So I'm just going to talk. If you would rather slides to read through, I've got them ready to go, but a lot of us spend our working days just staring at PowerPoint, so I'm going to try and avoid doing that. But if you'd rather, just ping in the chat to Mr. Hall, and then he'll tell me actually people want the slides. Okay, so let's get straight on then. So as we know, we are delighted that students are allowed to come back to school from the 8th of March, and we've been eagerly anticipating this for a while now. And I'm certainly very pleased about that. I think it's the right time. This is only my personal view, but I think it is the right time to get students back. Any earlier would have probably been too early, bearing in mind that the way the case rates are falling, but any later I think would have been an unnecessary delay. So it is my personal view that I think the timings are correct. Attendance is compulsory for all students, and the Prime Minister has made that clear. I'll talk about the actual return days in a moment, although they're the same as in the letters that I've recently written to you. And also that, you know, I really do believe that it's a safe time for students to come back. I saw the Secretary of State speak in the Commons, and then I saw the press conference afterwards, and Professor Chris Whitty, the Chief Medical Officer. Yeah, he was very, very confident and optimistic, far more than how I normally see the scientists present at those conferences. And he was really optimistic that it's the right time, it's safe. I didn't get any sense at all that they'd be looking for a significant increase in cases as a result of students going back, or that there was really any prospect of schools closing again once we get further out of the current situation. Obviously, the main reasons for that are we've got testing that we can now do in school. The case rates are coming down, and they are, you know, far, far lower than when they were at the height of the third wave in autumn. And obviously the vaccine. And I really do feel that the rollout of the vaccine is several steps ahead of any increased transmission of the virus. And I think that is going to be the thing that overwhelmingly keeps schools open and also gets society open, which I'm sure we're all looking forward to. So just the return arrangements, these are in the letter that I sent to you, and I've sent the letter out again. So we are allowing students we are slightly staggering the return of students. So on Monday, Years 10, 11, 12 and 13 will be welcomed back to school. So on Monday the 8th of March, years 10, 11, 12 and 13, you've been sent the time that you come back. So please arrive as close as you can to that time. Obviously don't arrive late because it will disrupt the systems we've got, but try not to arrive too early as well so you're congregating at the gates. On the 9th of March, that's the Tuesday, we're inviting years 7, 8 and 9 back to school. And once again, you've got times for when you're due to arrive, and please try to arrive as close to those times as possible. If students are not in school on the Monday, you'll carry on working from home. Teachers will set work for you to do, but there will be no live lessons on those days. Reason for that being that all staff in school teaching students that are returning and supporting getting students back in. So there'll be no live lessons, but work will be set. As students arrive back in school, all year groups will, the very, very first thing they do is they go to line up. Apart from the sixth form, they'll go straight to the hall. So they go to line up and then they are taken to the hall and they will do their what's called lateral flow device test, or you can call it rapid test if you want, for COVID-19. I'll talk a bit more about that in a moment. After all the students have been through the testing, they will then go to an assembly, and the assembly is there to prepare them and reboot the students for their return to school. And then straight after that, they're back into face-to-face lessons. So the objective is to get everyone back in face-to-face lessons as quickly as possible. Okay, just trying to think the best way to do this. So I'll just cover off what we're expecting on that day from students. So in terms of lateral flow device testing, the best way of doing this is to show you, I suppose. So these are the home test kits that staff have got, and then we'll be sending these out to students in a week or two. And these contain exactly the same things as the testing that's been carried out in school. So if you've got a child in school at the moment, or you know someone who's in school and all the staff in school, we've been doing these tests. They're really, really simple to administer. All you need is a swab. So this is just like a thin cotton bud. I'm not going to actually show you how to do it because it's a bit embarrassing. But you just take the swab and you literally just insert it into your nostril and move it around for 10 seconds. It really is that simple. It doesn't hurt. It's a little bit tickly, no worse than that. And I think we can put up with that. You then have to do a little procedure where you drop the swab into some liquid, into this little vial here. And then the test is carried out on one of these things. So I'm just opening the packet. And this little thing here is the actual lateral flow testing device. And all the person needs to do, whether you're doing it from home or whether it's done for the students in school, is you just put two drops of the liquid into that little section there. The liquid moves up along the capillary action inside the testing device, and at 30 minutes the result appears. So within 30 minutes you get the result of the COVID test, whether it's negative, positive or a void test. So these are great things because they're so quick, they're so easy. We've done hundreds and hundreds in school already. So as students return to school, like I said, the very first thing they'll do is they'll get their lateral flow device test. And then they'll go to assembly. In the subsequent days after they return to school, we will do a total of three lateral flow tests in school, and then we'll issue the home testing kits, and then you can do home testing kits indoors twice a week. They're also available for adults at home as well, and I've got a letter going out to you tomorrow which says how you can obtain testing kits for you to do, not just your children. There's ways that you can obtain these testing kits as well. So in the coming weeks, just for our school alone, thousands and thousands of rapid COVID tests are going to be done. And the objective is to try and detect anyone who may be asymptomatic for COVID. So as you're aware, about a third of people that have got COVID are asymptomatic. They don't show any symptoms at all. And these tests will be able to pick those up so they can self-isolate to reduce the transmission in the community. Okay, so that was lateral flow testing, and I'm sure there's a few questions about that, which I'm happy to take in a moment. Just the best order to do this. Yeah, the next part of this, I'll just cover the assemblies very briefly. The objective of the assemblies is, because students will go straight from their testing into assembly, and the idea of that is to reboot and re-establish our expectations now students are back in school. You're fully aware that Bacon's got really high standards of behaviour in school. We absolutely believe in disruption-free learning. We understand that students will have been out of their normal routine for what will be best part of 11 weeks by that point. So we're there to re-establish those expectations, re-establish those routines, get students in the right frame of mind, ready for their lessons. So if you can support us, please, I know you will, parents, to just make sure that when students come to school, that's it, lockdown's over, we're back to school, and our normal high standards, which everyone wants, will be in place. So that's the objective of the assembly. And I also want to communicate the message to you and to children when they come back, is that I'm going to share a personal frustration here when I read some quite high profile people in the media and in the news and so on, that use expressions like lost generation when they're describing school children of today. And they almost tell young people that their mental health and welfare has been damaged as a result of this lockdown. And I'm really anti that kind of language. I'll be absolutely clear about that. You know, it's not up for us as adults to tell young people their mental health has been damaged and to tell them their life chances have been affected. It's up for us as adults to communicate positivity, confidence and optimism. And we'll be aware of anyone who might have suffered difficulties during lockdown, of course, but that they will be a relatively small number. And we want to make sure that students feel a sense of positivity and confidence and optimism when they return to school. So we're going to absolutely stamp out that kind of language of lost generation. So I don't think it's helpful for young people at all. Okay, so I'm actually going to take a pause. I'm going to do it a slightly different way. I'm going to pause and ask Mr. Hoy if there's any overriding questions about either the lateral flow testing or the actual phased return to school.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. The first question is more an admin question. A few parents have said they haven't received the letters yet, and we know that there's been some issues with the post. Can we make those letters available on the website so that people can have a look at them and know the details of what you're saying in this presentation?
Yeah, absolutely. So I will make sure, bear in mind we've had some difficulties, tomorrow we'll put all the letters we've sent on the web, we'll email them to you if we've got your email address through ARBA, and we'll text out the link to the right page on the website as well. If by, I don't know, let's say lunchtime tomorrow, you haven't received what you need ready for Monday, email me directly or pick up the phone, and reception is always staffed until 4 o'clock each day.
Okay, thank you. Quite a lot of questions are coming in, so I'll just address them as they come in. Face masks, I know you're going to address later on. In general, are we going to be forcing students to wear masks, and what's our policy going to be on that? It's one of the most popular questions that's come through.
Yeah, I'm going to cover off face coverings in a minute. So I'll wait and field the questions on those at that time.
A few questions regarding assemblies. Are we going to be putting students into year bubbles when they have their assemblies? Will they be going and remaining within that bubble when they return to school? And just reiterating what the arrangements are for students when they come into school, have their test, have their assembly, and then move into their lessons, please.
Yeah, so the arrangements for all students are they come in at their designated
time. Mr. Wilson, we've just lost your sound. It's still gone. No, it's still not working. No, might advise you to log out and log back in, sir. May work. As you're doing that, I'll address some of the answers to the questions as best I can while you're doing that, sir. Okay. In terms of, for those of you that are not aware who I am, I'm Mr. Hall, I'm one of the vice principals. In terms of the assembly, I can reassure parents that students will be going into their assemblies in their year bubbles. One of the reasons we're having the staggered starts is to try and minimize any contact between different bubbles. One of the things we can't do, of course, is preserve the integrity of those bubbles with students as they come into school. So we would really stress and reiterate that students should be coming into school at the times that we've indicated. Once they've done that, there will be a holding area for students to come in to make sure that they are in their bubbles. Then they will move into the main hall. There'll be as socially distanced as we can make them. And then they will receive the assembly after they've done their test. At this point, Mr. Wilson's back. I just don't know if you want to check, sir, if you're...
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now, sir. So I was just finishing off by talking about the arrangements about assemblies and what was going on with those.
Thank you. Do you want to make me live, Mr. Reeves? Great, thank you. Sorry about that. It's going to happen again. I've got a terrible signature, so I never do anything from home. Okay, so I think Mr. Hall's covered that. Anything else, sir?
Some concerns about how the test actually works and how reliable the tests are. And maybe just a summary of the measures that we've taken to make sure that we're not cross-contaminating and what happens if, for an example, a student were to be tested on the day and they received a positive test.
Yeah, good point. And I'm glad someone has raised that, or more of you have raised that. So it is accepted that these lateral flow device tests are not as sensitive. That's different to reliable. They're not as sensitive as the test that you may have had so far if you've gone to a testing centre. So the ones, if you've gone to a testing centre or if they've been posted out to you, are called PCR tests or polymerase chain reaction tests. They are the gold standard of tests, and they are, you know, extremely sensitive, and that's what we've been using to date. These tests are not as sensitive, but they're good. There's not enough data out there that's conclusive about how, as a percentage, sensitive they are compared to a PCR test, but they are good. They're not as good, but they're good. Even if they were only 50% as reliable as a PCR test, that still means that if we test 1,000 students every week, you know, there's still a good chance we're going to pick up some asymptomatic cases if they're there. And if students do 3 tests a week, then the chances of it's only a 12.5% unreliability. So the more tests you do, the better, which is why we've been sent thousands of these test kits. You're going to have access to these test kits, and the more people that do them, the better the chance of finding asymptomatic people is. So yes, they're not 100%, that is accepted, but they're certainly better than nothing. And even if they detect just a couple of asymptomatic students or staff in school, that's a good thing. If someone is detected as positive, then they'll go through the normal routine of self-isolation. They'll get sent home or picked up, and then they'll have to do their normal self-isolation at home. The objective of the assembly on the first arrival in school is also that by the time we've gone through the testing and through the assembly, it'll be at least half an hour and all the results from these things will be in. So we can send students off the lessons with the confidence that no one's come up with a positive result. We do really need you to send those consent forms in. It's done on a Microsoft form. Follow the link that's on the letter that you've been sent, and I'll send it again tomorrow. The more of you that do that, we're up to a good completion at the moment. It's well over 65% at the moment. There's a bit longer to go. But please do fill in that Microsoft form. The more people we've got consent to test, the better the chance we've got of picking up asymptomatic individuals.
And then just following on from that, Mr. Wilson, can we summarise who is administering the tests and for how long those tests will be taking place in school?
Yeah, so everyone who's administering the tests are our own staff. So they've all been trained. So a small core of them were trained by the NHS themselves when the use of tests was first announced. Other people have been subsequently trained through webinars and so on. So it's all our own staff. They're all wearing PPE. They all know how to do it. The student actually does the swabbing themselves. So there's no actual contact between the person administering the test and the student. The student does their own swabbing in their nostril, and then everything is processed a bit behind the scenes, but it is really as simple as just dropping two drops onto this little plastic slide. It is no more difficult than that. So everyone's tested and they'll go on until the Tuesday of the second week. At that point, we'll dismantle the testing facility because we'll be relying on you to be doing those tests at home.
Could you, I'm not sure if it was clear or maybe after the point that you cut out, Mr. Wilson, but if a student were to test positive after receiving their test in school next week, what would be the process about what would happen with that student and the students around them if that were to take place?
So the student themselves would be taken to, we've got a separate room designated where if someone's either symptomatic or tested positive, they can be isolated straight away. Obviously, we do it very sensitively and we wouldn't make it too public. And they'll await either going home or collection. And anyone who we've identified as a close contact of them from that morning will also be taken out of lessons, and they will be sent home to start isolating like we were doing in the autumn term. So it is almost exactly as it would have been in the autumn term if someone was identified as positive or a contact of someone who's been positive. The need for self-isolation still exists. And I'll probably say at this point, rather than repeating it later, that all the normal rules around symptoms, you know, continuous cough, temperature, change of sense of taste or smell, all of that applies. So we must always be really disciplined that we don't come into school or work if we're showing those symptoms, if someone in our house is showing those symptoms.
A good question, and one that might come up again regularly, is what happens if a child is showing symptoms like the ones you've just described, but have a test and their test result is negative? Are they all right to be in school?
Yeah, they're fine to be in school if they're well.
Okay, thank you. A few related questions. I'm sure I'll... when you deliver the next part, Mr. Wilson, I'll go through and I'll try and summarise a few more questions. One or two that will keep coming up. We've been providing education for a lot of students on site all through lockdown. What are the arrangements for those students on Monday and Tuesday when we have the staggered opening, please?
Yeah, thanks for that. I probably should have said that in where I was talking through. The key worker and vulnerable groups, they continue in school on the Monday and Tuesday exactly as normal. So continue as normal, and as their relevant year groups come into school, they will go off and join them. The exception, I think Mr. Sargent has already communicated, is for year 10, because year 10 are joining on the Monday, there's not really enough time to come in and join their key worker group and then go off. So if at all possible, keep students at home until their year group does arrive in year 10. But if it's a real problem, it's no issue. You can just send them in.
Thank you. A question about exemptions. If students are exempt from wearing face masks, are we following the same procedure that we did before, whereby a student will subtly wear a badge on the inside of their blazer, and those are determined by Ms. Mataria and by Ms. Church in the office?
Yeah, that's exactly right. So I won't repeat it other than to say medical exemption is exactly the same as it was before. Miss Mataria and Miss Church coordinate that, and a subtle badge.
And the big question, are the tests mandatory? And what are we doing with students that do not want to take the test, or their parents do not give their consent?
They are not mandatory. It's a procedure that we must have consent for. So we're not allowed to write to you and say, we're doing it. If you object, let us know. We need direct consent from you. Sixth formers are an exception. Sixth formers can consent themselves. But everyone in year 7 to 11, we must have parental consent. Just send the consent form in. It's really quick to fill in. If you know any parents that haven't done it yet, please do lean on them to do it. The answer about what happens to students who don't do the test is simply they don't do the test. We can't make them do it. It's a real shame, I think, if we've got students that don't get tested, because it's there to keep everyone safe and protected. And I really can't think of any ethical, religious, health and safety related reason why someone wouldn't want to have the test. It's not an invasive procedure. It's not even a comparable argument to whether someone should have a vaccine or not. It is literally, sorry to be blunt, sticking a cotton bud up your nose. That is it. So there's no reason why someone shouldn't consent to that, in my view. So please do it.
All right, so at this point, I'll probably take a break and just try and get a handle on quite a lot of questions that have come through. If you'd like to do the next part of your presentation, I'll try and consolidate a lot of those together, and we'll do another Q&A in a short while.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm going to run through now the COVID protective measures. I'm going to go really quickly, promise, because effectively, virtually all of them are the same as we've experienced since September. Face coverings are the exception, so I'll spend longer on that. So first thing is, the main method of protection is to minimize contact with unwell individuals. So like I've just said, if someone's got symptoms or someone in their household has got symptoms, they should self-isolate it. They should self-isolate and book a PCR test and wait for the result to come in. If it's negative, come to school or come to work. I've talked about the lateral flow device testing, so I won't do that again. Hand washing. This is something we all need to be doing regularly, and we're all better practiced at this. We've got sanitizer around school everywhere. We're going to reissue the personal sanitizer bottles if people don't have them. But on Monday and Tuesday, students should bring in their sanitizer bottles. But we have got a couple of hundred to reissue them. And we've got bulk bottles to top those up in classrooms. Everyone needs to sanitize when they enter the school, after they eat, after they sneeze or cough, and every time they change room. And we will be insisting that students do this as part of the lesson and lineup routine. Okay, face coverings. So on the screen in front of you is the DfE guidance. I've just lifted it onto a slide. I'll just pause for a moment. So previously, students were wearing face coverings in the inside areas of the school, unless they had a medical exemption. That has now been extended to in classrooms, and we understand that is a temporary measure which will be kept up, which will be reviewed at Easter. And it's a precautionary measure that the health experts believe just makes the return to school that much safer for students, and we can do it at this time rather than waiting for another couple of weeks down the road. Staff, I've said to staff that because they can maintain social distancing at the front of the room, they can pull their face covering down when they're talking to the class. There's obvious benefits from that, but they'll replace them when they're circulating the room. But when students and staff can't socially distance, because obviously they're sat next to each other, then we are requiring face coverings to be worn. Some students do have medical exemption and they'll have the badges, and so you're aware of that already. And I'm going to be direct about this. I believe the overwhelming majority of students will comply. When we were insisting on face coverings last term, literally maybe three or four students in every year group didn't have them with them. We were giving them one to wear, and no one actually point blank refused to wear a face covering. I understand, and I totally get, that wearing a face covering all through your lessons and when you're moving through the corridor is not the best experience in the world, but I really believe it's quite a small sacrifice for being able to keep the whole community safe and being able to get back to school. And if we need to put up with it for 3.5 weeks, frankly, I think we can all do that. If a student's got an itch or something, they want to pull their face covering down to scratch the itch, you know, we're not going to tell them off for it, but we do expect all students to be complying with this. And if some students just simply won't comply with it, then we reserve the right to move them to a different room where they can do their work if they won't wear a mask. But, you know, ever the optimist, I'm really hoping that there'll be no serious objections to wearing a face covering and everyone will wear them. And once again, I just can't think of a satisfactory reason why people shouldn't wear a face covering. We know it's not particularly comfortable, but it's not the biggest sacrifice in the world. And we have the medical exemption there for people who need that. I'm sure there'll be questions on that, which I'll address in a moment. This is the slide that we'll show to the students, that the face covering's there to protect people around you, not the wearer. And so that sense of community spirit should hopefully win through. Once again, good respiratory hygiene, sneezing into a tissue, catch it, bin it, kill it. All of our rooms are ventilated. Even if they're air conditioned, the windows will be open to make sure there's constant fresh air in the rooms. Surfaces will be cleaned regularly, and we've increased the daytime cleaning to make sure that all surfaces are wiped down regularly as students move around the building. And there's lots here, so I can't go through everything, but I think you've already covered that year groups will be arranged as bubbles, and we'll separate those at breaks and lunchtime, so there shouldn't be contact between bubbles. If they do pass in the corridors, that's okay. That's very low risk, and that's always been acceptable. We do have one-way systems, and students must stick to them. We can't expect students to socially distance because it just doesn't work in a school environment. But where they are making deliberate and avoidable physical contact, they will be given a detention. So they shouldn't be cuddling, hugging, shaking hands, arms around each other's shoulders, all of that sort of stuff. All of those things which can be quite instinctive for young people, I think we're pretty much conditioned to be out of that. Can't remember the last time I shook someone's hand, to be honest. So that can't happen if it's deliberate and avoidable. Obviously, it means what it says. If it's completely accidental or it couldn't be avoided, we're not going to tell people off for that. But if it's clearly deliberate, then students will be issued a detention. Staff have been told to maintain distancing from each other and avoid face-to-face conversations within 1 meter. Groups will be for assemblies, so there can't be whole college assemblies. Every student's been issued a coloured badge so we can see clearly what year group they're in. We've got staggered start times, we've got staggered break times as usual, so that there's no change from that. I won't cover all of that because everything is the same as last time. Everything's done in year group bubbles. Detention's done in bubbles, lineup's done in bubbles, and that's how we can keep people separated. It's down to students, with your obvious guidance as well. After school and before school, we've got limited capacity to control how pupils regulate their behaviour. So we do expect students to comply on public transport. The staff at Canada Water in particular do get quite frustrated that students do go on the buses without wearing their face coverings. And they are reluctant to challenge them because they're young people and they don't want to be turning them off the buses. So if you can really insist that your child has their face covering and wears it on public transport and when they go to Sainsbury's and so on, because it is a requirement. Uniforms as normal, trips and visits are limited at the current time. Okay, right, so that's the protective measures and I'm gonna stop there. Mr. Hall, any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. A few questions about masks and exemptions and things like that. So the first question, if a student is unable to wear a mask, would we accept them wearing a visor?
The guidance, unfortunately, is very clear that visors are not a substitute for masks. So if a student can't wear a mask because of a medical exemption, let Ms. Church know in the office and they'll be given a medical exemption badge. And that's it. And we've got a number of students in that category, and they wear a very subtle badge on the inside of their blazer. And because they're so small in number, we know who they are anyway, pretty much. If someone doesn't want to wear a face covering because it's uncomfortable, a visor is not a satisfactory alternative because it just doesn't achieve the same outcome. A visor will restrict the transmission of droplets and aerosols onto another person, but it won't do anything about obviously air that's being breathed out from a wearer, because that will just go off around the outsides and the bottom of the visor. So the short answer is it's not a substitute, sorry.
And then second of all, linked to that is, how do we ensure that our students are wearing the mask, and what kind of process do we go through at the beginning of the day and throughout the day to try and ensure that as many of our students are wearing masks as possible?
Yeah, good question. So at lineup, everyone puts their mask on and then they're taken into their tutor groups in a very organised fashion. If a student does mislay their mask, we've got large stocks of those in school and we'll just issue one. So there'll be no telling off or anything like that. We'll just issue someone with a new face covering and we'll expect it to be put on. In corridors, if students are walking around the building, we will insist, and staff are out in the corridors making sure pupils wear them. We'll just make non-verbal cues like that if they're pulling their face coverings down to talk to their friend. But while they're in classrooms, I'm very confident that mask wearing will have a very high level of compliance, because the students will be sitting facing forward, and it's not like they won't be able to easily pull it down to talk to their neighbour. We've got to be totally realistic that, you know, if a student does pull their mask down just because they've got an itch or something like that, or they need to sneeze into a tissue, then of course that's fine. If we can make sure pupils are wearing their face coverings the vast majority of time, I think we've done a good job.
A question not on masks, but about students being vaccinated. Do we know anything about that at the moment, and will vaccinations take place in school? I know that's quite far into the future, but one or two queries about that.
I'm afraid I just can't answer that. I know they're rolling out the vaccine to, adults that unfortunately I will fall into that age category relatively soon, which doesn't please me at all in some ways. But how quickly that's going to get down to school age children, if at all, I simply cannot answer. And I don't know how they would roll out the vaccine to young people. As soon as I know anything, of course, I'll let you know.
I'm just in the process of answering this question, but are SNUDs an alternative to masks, or would we insist on students wearing masks that we provide if they don't have their own?
What's a SNUD?
One of the kind of like a mini halfway between a balaclava and the things that the students wear around their necks that can just prop up over their mouths. I'm also far more with it than you. So.
Right, it's an education for me. I don't like the sound of those, if I'm honest, at first glance. I think if it's a temporary measure and a student quickly pulls it up as they come into the school, then that's fine if they're just getting into a classroom quickly. But while they're sitting in a classroom, I'd really want them to wear one of these face coverings. These are relatively itchy. These are the ones we'll be issuing if students haven't got them. If you buy a cloth face covering, which I think, you know, virtually everyone's got now, a washable face covering, they are far more comfortable. So you've still got a few days left to get a washable face covering, and that can be used rather than these, because I find these slightly less comfortable.
Again, I'm just working my way through a number of questions, but some of them are crossing over into exams and assessments. And some of them are quite specific about the lateral flow test and the PCR test, and maybe we'll address those right at the end.
Okay, I'm going to go into exams now, and it's very short. So I'm going to pull up a little, it's called an infographic. It comes straight from the exams regulator Ofqual, and it's available for everyone to see. Before I put it up, I'll just say that I know students, particularly obviously in year 11 and 13, are really, and your parents are really, really itching to know what's going to happen in terms of grades this summer. And every time a new announcement comes out, it always opens up, you know, more questions than it answers. There is so much unknown at the moment that I can't give you a great deal more information. I am hoping, certainly by this time next week, to at least give you a timeline of how those grades will be awarded and what assessments will be taking place. But I'm not going to say anything I can't. I'm not going to give you inaccurate information, put it that way. So I'll give you limited information at the moment. And as I've got more, I will let you know. This is the graphic I was talking about. So what we do know is that grades will be awarded by teachers. We won't have an algorithm, which was used last year, and we all know that ultimately failed and they had to revert to teacher assessments. There will be assessments in school, or there can be assessments in school. We only intend to assess students on what they've been taught rather than what might have been missed. But in reality, we haven't actually missed anything. Some things might have been covered during lockdown, but virtually everything has actually been taught. We will make it clear to students what evidence we're using to establish a grade. And that's what we want to be able to say to students in the next few days is, for each subject, what are we going to use to base the grades that we're going to give on? So we are certainly, in many subjects, going to use assessments that have been done already. So, for example, the mock exams that were done in November, they were all done before lockdown started, so that's good evidence for us to use. In most subjects, we will be doing some kind of in-school assessment. I don't want to make it sound like these are a one and only exam and really raise the stakes of it, but nevertheless, we do need to assess where students are at the current time. So there is likely to be a suite of assessment in lots of subjects. Lots of subjects have what's called non-exam assessment. So we're talking about things like coursework and practical work. We will use that where possible, but where it's simply impractical because you just won't have time to do some of those things when you return to school, then we'll take a balanced view. Art and design grades can be based on portfolio work. And we could use question banks for a small number of questions. We could use work that's been done in class. The answer is a whole range of evidence can be used. And in the next few days, or certainly week or two, we want to be able to nail down pretty tightly the evidence we'll use. What I can say with certainty is the grade that we give will be fair, it will be unbiased, it will be awarded with professionalism and integrity. So we're not going to be deliberately difficult with students where a piece of evidence doesn't exist through no fault of their own. You know, we're not going to disadvantage our own students, of course we're not. But what we're also not going to do is just give out grades just because we've got the power at the moment to give out overinflated grades. That's not the right thing to do. Students, we will get the grade that we really believe, in our professional opinion, they would have got had exams have gone ahead. And I don't think anyone would expect anything else. And that's exactly what we did last year with year 11 and 13. And overall, the vast, vast majority of students got what they thought was a fair grade and they were satisfied with it. And the number of appeals was absolutely tiny. I think it was even one or two in the end. So that's how they'll be awarded. But you are clearly waiting for more detail about how that's going to happen. And I will let you know that as soon as possible. But anything I say at the moment will be premature, because lots of exam boards are still clarifying what they expect from us. And it's not fair on me to tell you in case an exam board does say something different later down the line. In terms of assessments in school, highly likely there'll be an assessment period over probably 2 or 3 weeks. Some subjects will use more assessments than others, but it's too early to confirm that. We're not going to be doing wholesale assessments apart from English literature before Easter. English literature was an exception because we couldn't do that exam in the autumn. So we're not going to go into a big period of mock exams as soon as you return to school. I don't think that's the right thing to do. We need to exploit the teaching opportunities we've got when you return. But shortly after Easter, it's almost certain that we'll be doing an assessment period. Results days are brought forward this year. So the results days are on the screen there for you. A-levels on the 10th of August, and ASs if you're doing ASs, and GCSEs on the 12th of August. So they are earlier this year. There will be an appeal system. It will go first of all to the school or college, and then it can go to the exam board. And schools will be subject to external scrutiny. So when we're awarding grades, we've got to make sure we've got the evidence to support those grades, and we've got to make sure those grades are fair and realistic. We could be inspected or subject to external scrutiny. And if the grades we've given out are too generous, they will be blocked by the exam boards. And we can't take that chance because that would disadvantage absolutely everyone in the school community. And so we just can't do that. So lots of unknowns at the moment, but there is a degree of certainty in terms of things like results days and the fact that there is no exams and it will be entirely awarded by teacher judgment. But just remember that teacher judgment must stand up to scrutiny, and we've got to make sure that our systems in school are robust. Okay, I think that's about it, Mr. Hall.
Okay, so lots of questions. Apologies, I didn't realise I wasn't muted. So if you hear me typing away there, I was trying to answer as many questions as I could. So following your section on assessment, can you just reiterate what date year 11 results day will be, and do we have in mind a timeline including key dates for year 11, such as the last day that they'll be in school and informing parents and students about decisions regarding sixth form. So quite a lot in there.
Yep, so results day for GCSE is the 12th of August. In terms of assessment calendar, I'm doing what I said I wouldn't do, which was tell you things that I can't stick by. But my guess is we'll be going into assessments probably a week or two after Easter. So my anticipation is that students will come back from the Easter break, and then within a week or two, we'll go into an assessment period. Once again, subject to confirmation, I'm expecting that the end date for students will be the May half term. So until we know the exact exam calendar, that can't be confirmed, but I'm anticipating that the May half term will be the end of school for students in year 11 and 13. We may need a bit of time after that, for example, where we're collating evidence, so students can't disappear off into the sunset because we may need them. But nevertheless, that's what we're anticipating. And that all builds up to, just get it in my calendar, on the 18th of June, I need to sign off personally all of our grades and make sure they're with the exam boards. So we obviously need a period where the students do the exams. We'll probably need at least 2 weeks for the staff to mark those assessments, a week or two to moderate the grades that have been given, and then get them off to the exam boards. And 18th of June is my absolute cutoff date where that needs to be done. In terms of admission to the sixth form, I know Miss Vass, head of sixth, is communicating regularly with year 11 students. We intend to also do bridging courses. So when the assessment period is finished, we can offer A-level bridging courses to manage that transition onto A-level. No sixth form places are obviously confirmed until the grades are released. So because we have the power to hold those grades before, it's highly likely we can confirm without doubt sixth form places earlier than the result says. But I can't say that for definite, because what the exam boards normally do is they normally say, you send us the grades that you're going to award, but they're confidential until such time that they agree. So it may be that we send the grades in, but we just are not allowed, for example, regulations to let the students know. So we don't know that yet. At the absolute latest, it will be the results days, which are the 12th of August.
And just to add on to that, the bridging courses that Mr. Wilson's referred to, those are likely to be beginning after the May half term. But following what Mr. Wilson's just said about how flexible we need to be regarding assessments, we can't confirm that yet. But we will certainly be informing yourselves and the students about that process. And that's likely to last for about 4 to 5 weeks once we have got confirmation of those dates. Linked to that question about assessments.
Sorry, before you just read that, 2 seconds. I just want to summarize as well that I really appreciate that parents and students in year 11 and 13, this is a difficult time, and it has been since this last lockdown has been announced. You want to know exactly what the plan is going to be, what you're going to be required to do. I know that, and I really do sympathise that you're in a position of uncertainty. You've got some certainty to an extent that you know they're going to be teacher assessed grades and so on, but there's a whole load of questions that throws up. I really do sympathise with you. I really do feel for you. We will let you know as soon as we possibly can. And I just want to try and reassure you not to worry. I really do think that it will all work out well in the end. It did last year, and I'm absolutely confident that you'll get the grade that you expect to get and you deserve to get based on the progress you've been making. So do try not to worry. Things will reveal themselves quite quickly and give you that certainty that you need.
There's two strands linked to that that have come out. One is, how will parents know what assessments year 11 have already done that will inform those grades, and what we will be using as additional information in terms of working out what that current assessed grade would be? And then there's another question following on from that.
Sure. So every student in year 11 and 13 has done their mock exams in the autumn. They were able to be done with virtually 100% completion in the autumn. English literature for year 11 was the exception, and we're going to deal with that when the students come back. So there's one piece of evidence we've definitely got. the weight of evidence, as you would expect, would probably shift towards closer towards the end of the course. Obviously, we want students to make as much progress as possible between November and May, and students do make a lot of progress in that time. Because every subject is so different, the best thing that I can do is to write to all parents in a week or two and just give you a simple table saying for each subject, this is what we will use, whether it's in the bank already, whether it's work that the students will be doing as they return to school, or whether it will be used as part of an assessment after Easter. I can't do better than that at the moment, because you know, I know heads of department are literally waiting for their own exam boards to say, these are what you should be using, these are the sources of evidence you should be using in this subject. And you can imagine the difference between coming up with a grade in subjects as different as drama, PE, art and design, music, English and maths. It's so different with such a wide range of evidence that it's too early for me to say, but I will summarize that for you as and when I know.
And then coming up from that question, not a concern, but a query about how we can ensure integrity when we award the grades based on a student's work and their performance, rather than any extraneous factors such as if they've been poorly behaved or they've not been engaging or things like that that might skew a teacher's perception of that student's performance.
And that's a good point, actually. And one of the conditions of the exam boards are that any kind of bias or discrimination would be regarded as a malpractice on a school's part. So we will certainly ensure that doesn't happen. All the grades that a subject wants to award will get initially moderated by the line managers, and the line managers of those subjects will do that with an analytical approach by looking at all the range of data that's available rather than the names of the students. And when I did this last year with various heads of department, you know, we actually just hid the columns on the Excel spreadsheet, so we couldn't see the names. We just looked at the data. Obviously there is a case for saying that we know what some students are capable of and what they're not, and it's not always as cut and dried as this is what they got in their test, so this is what grade they're going to get at the end, because we're not doing public exams. It's a point I probably should have made before. We can't do exams at the end of the year in the same way that would normally happen in a given year. So there is no substitute for that. So there is more opportunity for professional judgment and discretion, but it is my job and the line manager of those subjects' job to make sure that that's done done with integrity, and that any kind of bias plays no part in that process. And I won't sign off grades, and I won't sign off those results before I send them to the exam board, unless I'm absolutely confident that students have got the grade that they should be getting.
Thank you. I have some questions regarding interventions. If we start with SEND students first, what support are we going to provide for SEND students who've really struggled during lockdown?
We've had a good discussion about this with Ms. Mataria at SEMCO, actually. All the normal SEN support, whether it's students that are educated in the nurture groups or students that are educated in normal lessons and receive LSA support, all of that, of course, carries on. We've increased our level of mental health and wellbeing support in terms of counselling, in terms of organisations like Football Beyond Borders that are operating therapeutic support. And our primary intervention for students who may have SEND is what we call quality first teaching. So the quality of the lessons they get from their teacher, and Ms. Mataria has done a training session already, and we'll do another one in the first couple of weeks back on how staff can support students with wide ranging needs in their lessons. So all of the usual support that you would expect will be in place, but we will have a heightened level of awareness of any students that might have struggled during lockdown. We are doing assessments for year 7 to 10 in English and maths when students return. So that will identify, you know, quite diagnostically any students that may need more support as well.
Thanks. And linked to that is a broader question about our catch-up strategy and what that will look like. And will we be running classes during holidays, after school, on Saturdays, just as examples of the kind of interventions parents have mentioned?
Yep. Once again, catch-up strategy is something we've been working on quite extensively the last few weeks. We have got in progress a very comprehensive catch-up strategy that encompasses all sorts of things, from well-being to assessment to attendance to intervention and so on. So we will do that and roll that out. Some students will not have fallen behind. You know, we have to accept that they've engaged well and they've worked well. Other students will. Other students may have small gaps in knowledge that can be addressed through their normal lessons. So staff will be trained on using things like regular assessment, formative assessment, using diagnostic tools like Seneca, Hegarty, Sparks, and so on, to identify those gaps in knowledge and address those. We're very keen on something called the forgetting curve, which is when things are taught, it's very, very quickly forgotten, and teachers are increasingly skilled at identifying where things might have been forgotten and going through a series of regular low stakes quizzing to make sure that knowledge.
Mr. Woods, we've just lost you speaking again, I'm afraid. No, unfortunately, we've got the same problem as we had before.
Even come back again.
Oh, there we go. You're back.
I'm back. Yeah. So catch up will largely be dealt with through lessons and through the timetable. In terms of after school intervention, I'm keen that that is very targeted and it's used very effectively. I don't think that all students just simply doing more time in school on a routine basis is effective. It's got to be targeted. It's got to be diagnostic. One thing that students have gained during this last year is a real sense of independent learning ability. So, and we've gained tools, like I just mentioned, Sparks, Hegarty, Seneca, MyGCSE, Educake. These are great tools that we can now use to support pupils in catching up, which doesn't necessarily involve staying behind after school to have a revision class with your teacher for an hour. So that's all part of our catch-up strategy. In terms of weekend holiday work, I'm going to say that there's no firm plans for that yet. I think there's a place for it, but once again, it's got to be really targeted. And when the summer schools initiative was announced by the DfE, I think it was last week now, you know, a lot of the emphasis wasn't necessarily about learning. It was about those kind of social skills, those physical skills, those connections that students may have lost during lockdown, rather than students coming in to do 2 weeks of a summer school. Because I don't want to sound glib about it, but realistically, being out of school for 11 weeks is not going to be made up but by a couple of weeks of a summer school for maybe 25 to 50 students, for example. And frankly, I want students to have a good summer and to have time with their families. I certainly want to have time with my family over the summer, and I'm sure you do as well. So there will be intervention going on. There will be some kind of holiday activity, but it is too early to start making firm plans for that.
And linked to that, a few queries around the summer holidays. Will they be shortened, and will we expect students to be finishing later or coming back to school earlier?
No, there's no plans for students to finish the term later and no plans for them to come back from their summer earlier. That's not suggested by the DfE at all. I wouldn't support it. I think students, staff and parents do need to have that time during the summer holiday after what has been a challenging year, to say the least.
And then linked to that, Mr. Wilson, in more general terms, will we be running extracurricular activities such as sports or chess clubs or things like that when students return next week?
Yes, is a simple answer. We're very keen to get going on our extracurricular activities straight away. Just in terms of sports, that tends to dominate the extracurricular. I have told Mr. Pike, the head of PE, just to hold off for the first week because there's going to be quite a bit of disruption in terms of getting students back to school, doing their lateral flow tests and so on and so forth. So I really want to just establish some routines and rigour in the first week, but after that, we've got the green light from the DfE for normal extracurricular activities to resume.
And then just a more generic question, and you've addressed it in several different ways, but as a holistic question, what is our strategy for making sure that our students' emotional and mental health is looked after when they return to school, rather than just focusing on the academic?
Yep, and I did a session with the staff yesterday on all of the various opportunities to identify and support young people with their mental health. All the students either have or will be emailed out something from Mr. Sargent about all the various external agencies that can support them. As I said, we've increased our in-school provision from things like our counsellor, therapeutic support from Football Beyond Borders and other outside agencies. And staff are aware, and awareness is really key, that some students will have struggled during this period and will struggle to adapt coming back to school. And so having that awareness is absolutely crucial. And any students we identify as struggling, we will certainly put in support for them. And likewise for parents, if we can help you in any way, do please get in contact. And if you're aware of any difficulties your child might have been experiencing, then let us know so we can be aware and prepared for that from the day the student arrives back in.
There's quite specific questions about PCR tests and LFD tests, and I think probably the best way to address those is to address those offline. And we put something on the website that parents and staff can download and would answer the questions that way, rather than they're quite specific. So I think that we'll do it that way. And apart from that, I think we've addressed the majority of the questions that have been asked. Apologies to any parent who's got a specific query that they've been asking, but I think I've covered the sense of what people need to know ahead of returning next week.
We'll happy to have a go at a PCR LFD test question if you want, Chris, but otherwise, like I say, we can put it up. Do you want to give it a go?
Yeah, so for example, what happens if a child receives a positive lateral flow test at school, then goes on to take a PCR test, which is more reliable, and gets a negative result? Can they return to school? Is there a need for them to self-isolate after a negative PCR test?
My understanding of it is, and we'd always check this with NHS test and trace first, is that if a lateral flow device test is done in school, that the students should, and staff actually, they have to isolate regardless of any PCR result. If a student does a home lateral flow test and it's positive, they then do a PCR test. And if the PCR is negative, they come back to school. So it depends whether it's done in school or whether it's done at home.
If a student or a person already tested positive within the last 90 days, do they need to take a test?
Yeah, the guidance is that they carry on being tested in school and they won't give a false positive.
Thank you. And I think that we've covered the majority of the questions. Again, apologies to individual parents if we've not answered a specific query, but there's a lot of crossover, and I think that we've addressed the majority of what parents have been asking and are concerned about.
That's great. Well, thank you very much, everyone. I always think I'm going to do these in about half an hour, but one day I'll achieve it. But there's a lot going on, obviously lots to talk about, lots to think about. We are genuinely and really looking forward to seeing everyone back next week. If you've got any specific concerns or anxieties or worries, get in touch with me, Mr. Hall, or your child's form tutor, or so on, and we'll do our best to help you out. I just reiterate the very, very first point I made when I opened. I really do think it's the right time for students to come back to school. I really think it's safe. I'm very confident that the case rates will remain low. There will still be a few self-isolations, I'm sure, because people might be showing symptoms, even if they turn out not to be COVID. But I'm confident and certainly hopeful that this will be the last lockdown and school closure we'll all be in. So that's it then. So thank you very much, everyone. Really grateful for you turning up. Like I say, I'll send out the recording and we'll place it on the website for you. So just have a good evening. Have a good weekend. You take care. God bless. And I'll see you soon. Bye bye.